Thank you very much. I'm Ted. I am a privacy, data, and technology lawyer. I work with a firm called Womble Carlyle. I'm also the chair of an ABA cyberspace law committee, American Bar Association, and I am a co-author of a couple of books on privacy along with Teresa Payton, who spoke here yesterday. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about privacy today, and in particular, what I'm calling the gasping death of the reasonable expectation of privacy. And we're going to discuss a little bit about why you should care about that. But first of all, join me in a little bit of imagining. You are at home with the family. It's a quiet time. All of a sudden, boom, the door opens. In come the police, rushing in, stormtroopers, heads covered, you can't even see who they are. They've got their hair trigger assault rifles. They come in, they grab you, and amidst the barking dog and the screaming children and the wailing spouse and the wailing you, they pull you out into the night. Can they do that? Well, it depends. Or let's think of something a little less physical and more insidious. What happens when those police want to know what you've got going on in your house before they come break in? And so they find ways to watch you. There's ways to be able to tell from outside your house where, using heat signatures, where you're moving or what you're doing and who's in what room. There are ways, looking at your power signatures, to figure out what you're using in your house that's using power and how that's working. There are ways to listen to you using your cell phone, the microphone that's on that, using the microphone in the Hello Barbie that your daughter has or your son has. We don't judge here at RSA. Or your computer. They can also look in the cameras, either your safety cameras, your security cameras, your camera that's on your computers. Your Xbox, which actually has facial recognition on it, they could pick that up too and watch and see everything you do in your house. Can they do that? Well, we know they can do that technically, but are they allowed to do that? Well, it depends. And what does it depend on? Well, ultimately it depends on either whether they can get a warrant to do that or whether they even need a warrant to do that. And in order to get a warrant or see whether they need a warrant, there's a standard we use, and that standard is called the reasonable expectation of privacy. Because if you have a reasonable expectation of privacy, there are certain things that the police can't do without a warrant. They can't come get you out. They can't come listen in on you. And so this is an important thing for all of us. So what we're going to talk about today is that I see the legal standard that we're using, this reasonable expectation of privacy, withering away like a plant that you haven't watered for the last month. It's a legal standard that's used by the government to protect your privacy, and it's withering away. And so, what's making it wither away? So let's make this work. The fact that we are in a more and more connected world. If you've been in this room at all the last couple days, you've been hearing a lot about the Internet of Things. More things are being connected. We have your son or daughter's Barbie there. We have your car, which is connected. The various things that can listen to you, can see you, and they're just growing all the time. And so the question is, what reasonable person would expect to have privacy when all of this is around us? So technology is taking your privacy away. But the question is, will it dissolve your right to privacy in the US? And that's what we're going to look at today. So today's roadmap for what we're looking at is we're going to talk a little bit about the reasonable expectation of privacy. What is it and how we use it? We're going to talk about how advances in technology are slowly strangling the reasonable expectation of privacy. And then that brings up the question of, if we can never reasonably expect privacy, what happens? What do we do from a legal standpoint? Where does our privacy go? Is it still protectable? So that's what we're going to look at. So first of all, what is the reasonable expectation of privacy? Well, as we said before, it's a legal standard. It's the standard that's used to decide whether certain things can happen to you in your life. For example, can the FBI take your DNA without your permission and without a warrant? Sometimes it can. And there are cases where that happens pretty much every day, but not where there was a reasonable expectation of privacy. We use it to decide whether your boss can read your email. So it's not just a government thing. We use the reasonable expectation of privacy really to talk about when anyone in power can violate your privacy or can do things to you that you don't want them to do. And of course, we use it to decide whether the police can take a look at your cell phone. I mean, if you're driving along, you get a traffic stop, you've got your cell phone sitting next to you in the car, can the police pick that up and just sort through it to see if you're doing anything that they find unsavory? Well, do you have a reasonable expectation of privacy on the phone? Some courts say yes, some courts say no. Something we have to decide. So what is this really? The reasonable expectation of privacy, the legal standard, is a dividing line. It's the dividing line between privacy and intrusion. And the issue is that right now, the dividing line is over here, protecting your privacy. It's slowly moving toward the other side because of all the technology that we have that is stepping in and making it unreasonable for you to feel private. So here's the question. Is this standard in the U.S. Constitution? Well, no, it's not. So it's not a standard that we have to comply with or that we'd have to change the Constitution somehow to affect. The Fourth Amendment of the Constitution is pretty clear. It gives us the foundation for what we're talking about. It protects the right of the people to be secure in their persons, their houses, their papers, and their effects. So this has been interpreted by courts, and particularly the Supreme Court, to say that you likely have a certain right of privacy. But they didn't come up with the standard in the Constitution as what that means to have a right of security and or privacy in your stuff. So how did the right of privacy, the reasonable expectation of privacy, come about? Well, it basically came out of academia. In 1890, a couple of guys named Warren and Brandeis wrote an article the Harvard Law Review that said that there should be more of a right of privacy. Now, they were basically worried about the gossip that was being spread by the newspapers about their wives when they held parties in the posh parts of Boston. So thank goodness they didn't live to see TMZ. But this was their major concern. And as it turned out, Brandeis in particular of these two was a brilliant, brilliant legal scholar. Brandeis got put on the Supreme Court, U.S. Supreme Court, and he many years later, began to work this reasonable expectation of privacy standard into his writings. It first came up in 1928, and interestingly, in a technology case, just like we're talking about now. The technology case dealt with the new technology of the time, which was a telephone. Not that the telephone was absolutely new at the time, but it was newly pervasive. Everybody was starting to get one. And so Brandeis said, looking at this new technology, there's a lot that people are expecting to be private on that they are not necessarily private. And so in this dissent, he raised the reasonable expectation of privacy, and it got moved into the thinking of the court from then on. So how's the standard used today? Well, it's pretty much used as you would think. To decide constitutional search and seizure cases, to limit warrantless police investigations, and to measure the intrusiveness of employers and the press into our lives. So now that we know that, how are advances in technology killing it? Because that's really what I'm here to talk about today. Well, keep in mind, 1890 is when this was suggested. Think about privacy in 1890. Privacy was everywhere in 1890. You just had to walk out the back door at night and nobody knew where you were. It was dark. You know, electric lights were only in a few cities. You really could only see distance if you're in a balloon or a tall building or maybe a mountain somewhere. You know, we didn't have the satellites or airplanes or anything else to look at that. And cameras only worked if you stood absolutely still for the picture to be taken, and had to be set up and operated by a particular professional. You know, and now, you know, when you think about the dark now, there's plenty of people that I know that have never lived a moment of their life in real dark. You know, they've always got lights on, and they've probably never even been out in the dark of a moonless night without lights around. So, you know, that's interesting, and it makes for much more productivity in the evenings for us. However, it really steps in and affects our privacy when things can be seen almost everywhere we are, whenever we are. And now we're also tracked by all these global and local systems of cameras. And on top of that, mobile tracking, you know, your cars are tracked, your phones are tracked. You've been hearing it here for the last couple of days. There's stationary sensors everywhere. We've seen cameras out in this building all over. And on top of that, they're all connected, and they're connected into databases which can be searched. So there's a lot going on right now which is affecting your privacy. Cameras are everywhere, and they're building metadata around what it is that they're seeing. And now we have this whole online thing. Online, we each have an online life, which is different than our regular life. I mean, you may be Goat Boy 123 out in your online world, you know, when you're John Smith here. You're doing lots of shopping online. You're doing, as far as we've seen, you're communicating online, and all of this is being captured. So it keeps getting worse. Tracking systems are moving into more and more devices. Facial recognition and other biometrics are moving into more and more devices. Vocal recognition and continues to get worse as the online providers are getting more sophisticated and they're taking better records of everything that we do. So, and the thing we're seeing, if you're watching the Apple case at all, it's an indicator of what I'm talking about here, which is there's constant pressure from law enforcement to continue to get deeper and deeper into invading our privacy. I listened to a talk in Congress. It was a hearing that was held by the senators talking about privacy issues, and they had like 20 people come on and talk about how terrible some of these tracking systems were and how women were being threatened by it. And I mean, just sob story after sob story, people were very upset about it. And then the guy from the FBI came on and said, basically, to heck with that, we need everything. We need all data, we need it right now, and we need you not to stand in the way of it. It was like, have you been listening to the people that were here before? But law enforcement wants to get their job done, and so they will push as far as we let them and as far as the law lets them. And as the new technology comes in, a very sophisticated group of law enforcement lobbies for what they want, pushes for what they want within the executive, and tends to get what they want in general. So that's pushing us. And we get to the point of how can it possibly be reasonable to expect any kind of privacy? I mean, we might expect it now, but as this gets worse, 5 years from now, 10 years from now, when does it get to the point that it becomes totally unreasonable to expect that we have privacy anywhere? It's going to happen. So that brings us to the final question, which is, if we can never reasonably expect privacy, what happens? Well, one of two things can happen. Thing one, we don't have any protectable privacy anymore under the Constitution. Now, there is no way to sue people or to stop the law enforcement or other powerful people from getting into your life. Lives. I mean, there's just no way to do it. So that's thing one, but that thing is very hard to think about. It would make for a really depressing world. So there is a second option, which is we simply choose a new standard, and we can do that. Yes, of course, we can absolutely choose a new standard. The reasonable expectation of privacy is not enshrined in the U.S. Constitution. And other nations don't have the reasonable expectation of privacy, or they handle it very differently than we have handled it. And so this is something that can easily be changed. It can be changed by legislature, or it can be changed and put into place as this standard was, by the Supreme Court. So there's a number of ways that we could have this changed so that if the reasonable expectation of privacy just slips away and slips away and slips away, we'll have something else to take its place. And so I want to fight for that thing to take its place. One of the things we could choose to take its place is a more objective standard. And I've listed here what I think a more objective standard could look like. That certain acts that we take, certain acts, matters, and behaviors are simply private. Some things that we do, if we decide to do them in a private space, should be considered private, objectively. Period, the end. You know, and that doesn't mean that nobody can check you if you just say, hey, I'm doing one of those things that you're not supposed to be looking at. It means that somebody would need to get a warrant or a court order to check into that, which is fine because there's process behind that. But now, if they don't have to do that, they can just look in on you no matter what you're doing. The second piece of this is you'd want to exclude the government from collecting and viewing data about those behaviors that we're talking about, those private behaviors, without a warrant. And then the third thing is intrusion of passive technology can't affect what you consider a private space. So in other words, if I go into my bedroom or bathroom or someplace like that that I think of as a private space, even my car parked in my garage, and I have my phone with me, which has all sorts of tracking technology and a microphone and a camera and everything else with it, that it doesn't automatically mean that I don't have privacy just because I have that thing with me. So that I see as an objective standard and something that we could put in to replace this as the reasonable expectation of privacy disappears. Europe, as you heard just in our previous discussion, has an entirely different way of looking about this, and they have entirely different standards. So it's easily doable. So I simply make a call out to everyone. Before our scope of protectable privacy completely shrinks until there's nothing important left to protect, let us try and move to a more objective standard. So don't let Hello Barbie take away your rights. But join me in pushing for a more objective standard before we lose the old one. Thank you very much for listening today.